remember that. In 2 Corinthians 5:20, it says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's who we are. And then in 2 Peter chapter 1, let me just read a few of the first verses here. Peter's writing, he says, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Listen to this. Through these He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. We get to participate in the divine nature. Wow! So yes, we are sinners saved by grace, but according to the Bible, we are also saints. We are the righteousness of God through Christ. And sometimes we just need to remember who we really are and be encouraged by that. Thank you, David. So that was a good word. All right, it's time for kids' church. We'll let the kids go right now. It's age 3 through grade 4. We have been talking about renewal, and I was thinking before I even came this morning that, if we're really serious about renewal, we need to be prepared for the pushback that the enemy is going to give us. Okay? And then I heard some commentary along that line this morning. I think discouragement is partly because the enemy doesn't like that we're in this theme of renewal and that we're getting serious about going after God. The enemy's not going to like that. And so let's just be honest. We need to be prepared for what he may bring us. And we've talked about this before. This isn't really in my sermon, but, the devices of the enemy, he loves to bring division. Get us bickering and fighting with each other. He loves to bring deceit. Some false little teaching that sounds pretty good, but it's really not right. You know what I'm talking about? He loves to bring distraction. Some other thing comes up that's now consuming our time when we really wanted to devote our time to pursuing God, and now something else is taking up all of our time. Distraction. And then I think another big one is discouragement. Some things start going wrong. The enemy's getting in there trying to mess us up. And, some of those things we're going to have to deal with. I'm not saying you can just, ignore them and pretend they're not there. But let's not forget what track we're on. We're on a track for renewal. We are going after God. And if the enemy brings junk against us, we're going to stand up firm and we're going to keep on pressing on. Right? Okay. Good. Well, this morning I want to talk about seeking the Lord. It's time to seek the Lord. We've been talking about this renewal, a new wine that I believe God wants to pour in the church today. So we need to be renewed individually and as a church together. We need to be renewed because if God's going to pour new wine into us, it's going to cause us to stretch and we're going to have to grow with His presence. And so we need to be made new. And we've been talking about some ways that we can be made new and renewed. Let's just review briefly here. We need to wash in the Word and get a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. And I've shared, and I'm still doing it, I've changed the way I do my devotional times in the mornings. I sit down with my Bible. I have a notebook. My tradition has been I'll read and I'll jot down some notes, maybe some things that I want to dig a little deeper on. Sometimes it inspires a sermon thought and all of that. But lately, I've simply been starting with the Word and say, Lord, just wash me in Your Word today. And then I intentionally am not taking any notes because I am just asking God for a fresh washing. Now, I'm not going to do this forever, but this is the season I'm in, that I'm not trying to get study notes and nuggets. I'm just, Lord, wash me in your word. Just wash me in your word. Ephesians 5:26 talks about that. And we need a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. We need to make some personal changes. And I just shared one simple one that I'm doing. And we need to get rid of some junk. You know, sinful tendencies and things that are distracting. Some distractions aren't always from the devil. They're just things we set up for ourselves. You know? So sometimes we need to get rid of junk. And we need to turn to God and we need to pray. And next week we've got the prayer meeting. And we need to prepare a way for God. And we talked about this last week. We need to raise the valleys. Those are things in our life that are less than God's best. We need to bring them up to God's standard. And we need to lower the hills. Those areas in our life that are kind of resistant to the things of God, those need to come down. And then we need to smooth out the rough places. Those inconsistencies in our faith walk need to be smoothed out. And we are paving a road for the King of Kings to come and make visitation upon us. So let's prepare the way. Now today we're in Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. Just one verse. Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. Just this one verse, and yet there's some really good nuggets for us today. Here's what it says. Sow for yourselves righteousness. Reap the fruit of unfailing love. And break up your unplowed ground. For it is time to seek the Lord until he comes and showers righteousness on you. Church, we want those showers of righteousness, don't we? We want those times of refreshing, or as the old song saying, showers of blessing, you know. We want that. We need to be renewed. And so I say, church, it's time for us to plant. Here he talks about sowing in righteousness, being truthful, doing right, doing good things. It's time for us to plant. Sow the seeds that God has for us. And you need to understand that you reap what you sow. That's a biblical principle, and it's a principle throughout all of creation. You reap what you sow. Galatians chapter 6, 7 and 8. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Okay, there's the Bible says it, so it's not just me. Then it says, the one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. And so you reap what you sow. If you want renewal, you're going to have to sow seeds of renewal. There's an Arabian proverb. He who plants thorns must never expect to gather roses. Okay? And, you know, this is farm country. You sow seed, corn, you're not going to get a bunch of wheat. Right? You're going to get corn. And here in Hosea, the very next verse, God says to the people, you have planted wickedness and have reaped evil. You have eaten the fruit of deception. So you reap what you sow. If we want renewal, we've got to start planting seeds of renewal, getting washed in the Word, getting a fresh anointing, spending time with God. That's all the seeds. You know, it's been said, you sow a thought and you reap an act. You sow an act, you reap a habit. You sow a habit and you reap a character. And if you sow a character, you reap a destiny. So these tiny little steps that we're taking of renewal can lead to one thing and another thing and so on to where our entire destiny is shaped by these little seeds that we're planting now. Let's plant seeds of renewal, because you reap what you sow. And not only that, but you reap in proportion to what you sow. Okay? 2 Corinthians 9:6. Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Jack Exum says that while he was in Canada, he says, I visited a believer who operated a large grain farm. His spread included thousands of acres, And he said, I asked him how he planted the seed, and he reached in the bin, pulled out an ear of corn, and then proceeded to pop out the kernels one by one as he walked along, demonstrating the planting process. Now, do you believe that? A guy with a 1,000-acre farm is going to seed at a time? No, that's not what he said, and it's not what he did. Actually, he says, he showed me a distributor that was some 30 feet wide. And he says, we take that double tandem truck, fill it with certified seed, back it up to the distributor, open the slots, and pour in the seed. He went on to say, if you're ever going to be cheap, don't be cheap with the seed. One bushel of seed invested yields 30 bushels of grain harvested in a good year. 30-1. Not a bad return if you're ready to believe and willing to invest. And God says, believe me, trust me, try my plan, prove my ways, and see the kind of harvest that I will give. You reap in proportion to what you sow. How bad do you want renewal? Okay, well, I need to back up and crawl over. I think some of us need a complete overhaul. Okay? You want me to start calling out names? Okay. We need an overhaul. We need a renewal. And so let's not just tinker around, but let's pour in the seed so God can bring a mighty harvest our way. Okay? Now, when we talk about this sowing and reaping, this planting and harvesting, things come to mind. Okay? The Bible clearly talks about giving in this context. You know, you give. And so just a simple question. Have you been sowing into God's kingdom? Okay? Because God says he blesses us when we give into his kingdom. Okay? Evangelism. Have you been sowing seeds of evangelism? Have you been telling the good news? Because the harvest comes after you sow the seeds of good news. We want people to get saved to come to Christ, right? So we got to sow some seeds. Simple enough. And, you know, I gave you one real easy thing. Out there at the information center, there's these little cards that says you're invited. And it just invites them to come to church. It's a simple little thing you can do. There's 100 other ways you can encourage somebody and tell them about Jesus. Your personal testimony is one of my favorites. Has Jesus affected your life? Yeah. Okay. Here's another one. Real practical. Friendliness. You need a friend? Then be a friend. Okay? Don't just wait for somebody else. You go ahead and reach out and be a friend. And then here we're talking about renewal. You want renewal? Then let's plant seeds of righteousness. Righteous living. Washing in the Word. Drawing close to God. That's going to reap the harvest of renewal. And so you reap what you sow. You reap in proportion to what you sow, but then you reap after you sow. Okay, now that seems like a no-brainer, but sometimes we need to be reminded. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Okay? You know the only way you're guaranteed to not get a harvest? Don't plant anything. Okay? But if you plant and you tend to the garden or the crop, there's going to be a harvest. Okay? Now, God determines just how large the harvest is going to be, but there's going to be a harvest if you plant some seeds. So don't give up. Never think that God's delays are God's denials. Just because something's taken a little longer than you thought doesn't mean God is done. Understand? We often expect God to give us a harvest of souls or a harvest of finances when we haven't planted anything. Or we want renewal, but we haven't made any preparations. God says, you plant, I'll bring the harvest. You give, I'll bless you. You prepare the way, I'll bring renewal. That's the way it goes. You after you sow. So this is a time for us to plant and sow. Malachi 3:10 talks about our finances. It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. Now, we all love that last part. So much blessing that you won't have room enough for it. Yes, sign me up. And God says, well, you need to plant the seed. You give, and then I'll do that. Luke 6:38 has a similar theme. Give, and it will be given to you. So we plant the seed, and then God brings the harvest. In Matthew 6:33, Jesus himself said, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And in the context, he's talking about all the things in life that we are concerned with. We are all concerned with making a living, having food to eat, having a place to stay, taking care of our families. And Jesus says, but if you'll put God's kingdom first, then all those other things will come right behind it. And so often we get so focused on those things and we ignore God's kingdom. But Jesus says, no, 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 no. Put God's kingdom first. Sow the seed into God's kingdom. And then he takes care of all the other things for us. And I mentioned last week on renewal, Malachi 3:1, God says, you prepare the way, and suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. We want a visitation of God, don't we? We want revival. We want renewal. Well, then we need to prepare the way. So it's a time to plant, church. This is the season we're in. Time to plant. Let's plant seeds of righteous living. Let's plant seeds of evangelism and kingdom giving and preparation for renewal. Let's sow the seeds so God can bring these times of refreshing that we so long for. And it's also time to plow. He says, soften your hearts, the soil of your heart. And that reminds me of the parable of the sower that Jesus talked about. You know, he threw some seed out, and some of it landed on the path where birds came and ate it. Some landed on rocky places where it was scorched by the sun. Some landed among thorns where it was choked. But some landed on good soil where it produced a crop. Good soil is soft. You know what I'm talking about? What's one of the first things gardeners do? You go out there and till, and you plow, and you get that soil turned up and soft so that the seed can get embedded in there. And so we need to plow. We need to break up our hardened hearts. Psalm 34:18 says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Now, clearly when you read that, he's close to the brokenhearted, saves those who are crushed in spirit. We immediately think of somebody who has gone through a very difficult time and they're feeling broken and crushed, and we understand that God is right there caring for that person, right? But I also believe it suggests that if we keep a heart that is soft before the Lord, even without all the troubles, but just keep a tender heart, God is near us. He's close to us. He loves people with a tender heart. He's attracted to them. Somebody said hardening of the heart is more serious than hardening of the arteries. It's true. We need a tender heart. Psalm 51:17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. It's time for us to plow up the hardness in our hearts. Bob Hartman wrote this song, and let me just share a few of the words. Don't let your heart be hardened. Don't let your love grow cold. May it always stay so childlike. May it never grow too old. Don't let your heart be hardened. May you always know the cure. Keep it broken before Jesus. Keep it thankful, meek, and pure. That takes me right back to one of my themes that I come back to over and over again. The power of thanksgiving. The power of gratitude. One of the ways you keep a tender heart is to be grateful for the things that God is doing in your life. It keeps you humble and soft before Him. When you get proud and you're not grateful for anything, but you feel like you've done everything to achieve it, then your heart becomes hardened. But if you acknowledge the work of God in your life and you express gratitude to Him, it keeps your heart soft before Him. And we need to plow up our hardened hearts. And we need to also plow up and break up our excuses. I spent a whole sermon talking about this a few weeks ago, but I'm touched on it again today. In Luke 9, 59 and following, Jesus says to a man, "Follow me." But the man said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." And still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus replied, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." We're full of excuses. Yeah, it is so easy to come up with reasons why I'm not walking the way I should. So easy. We need to get rid of the excuses. Some people intend to follow the call of God, but other things come first, and then they never heed the call. Has God spoken to your heart? Then stop resisting. No more excuses. Follow God's call. Even if you haven't received a specific call, there's a general call that God has put on all of us as followers. And it's time for us to do what we know is right. It's time to follow Jesus wholeheartedly. A guy was sharing, he says, "I was driving down a bumpy country road when I saw a bag of cement beside the road. It appeared to have fallen off a delivery truck as it hit one of the bumps in the rough road. And being a person who does not like to see anything wasted, I stopped to pick up the lost bag of cement. I can use that. When I reached down to pick up this heavy bag, to my surprise, I discovered it was not soft and limber as I had expected, but had solidified into an immovable piece of cement." And often our lives are like that bag of cement. They take on shapes that were not intended and become hardened in that shape. That bag of cement was supposed to become a part of some beautiful structure, because it did not reach its place of service, it became a useless rock in a form of a bag of cement. God wants to make something beautiful of your life. And don't let His purpose be thwarted by a bump in the road of your life. I've actually had cement harden in the bag before. And you know what that's good for? Nothing. Useless. You know, but if I need it for a set of fence posts or something, I need it still in the soft form, then I can pour it in and mix it up, and then it's useful. Don't let the bumps in the road of life take you off of God's purpose and cause you to be hardened in a shape that He never intended. So let's plow up the hardness and soften our hearts before God. And then, church, it's time for us to pursue. Here it says, "Seek the Lord until He comes." That idea of seeking the Lord is actually to tread out a path. It's kind of like a cow pasture. And if you've ever been around a cow pasture, you know, pretty soon there's trails. They follow a regular path, and that trail gets beaten down because they go over it and over it and over it and over it. That's the idea of seeking God, to pursue Him, to wear out a path, because I just keep coming back to it and back to it and back to it. I am pursuing God. And it says, "Seek the Lord until He comes." So that's not a half-hearted effort. It's not a, well, I prayed today. I asked God for renewal. No, it's way more than that. It's over and 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 over again and again and again. I'm pursuing God. I'm seeking the Lord until He comes. Not giving up. And we need to pursue God's kingdom and His will. I already mentioned Matthew 6:33. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Put God's kingdom first. His kingdom should be our number one priority. We should be concerned about the things of God before we are concerned about other issues. In the order of our day, talk with God first thing. In our finances, give to God your first fruits. In making decisions, ask God what His will is first. Colossians 3:1-2. Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. So let's pursue God's kingdom and His righteousness. Spurgeon, famous preacher, said, if you're not seeking the Lord, the devil is seeking you. If you're not seeking the Lord, judgment is at your heels. And we need to pursue God Himself. Amos 5:6 says, seek the Lord and live. A.W. Tozer says, the church will come out of her doldrums when we find out that salvation is not a light bulb only. It is not an insurance policy against hell only. But it is a gateway into God, and that God is all that we would have and can desire. Let's just pursue God. Jeremiah 29:13, God Himself says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. We want God. We want to see God. Then we have to go after Him. Pursue Him. There's an ancient tale from India about a young man who was seeking God. And he went to a wise old sage for help. How can I find God? He asked the old man. The old man took him to a nearby river. Out they waded into the deep water. Soon the water was up just under their chins, and suddenly the old man seized the young man by the neck and pushed him under the water. He held the young man down until he was flailing the water in desperation. Another minute and he may well have drowned. Up out of the water, the two of them came. The young man was coughing water from his lungs and still gasping for air. And reaching the bank, he asked the man indignantly, what did that have to do with finding God? The old man asked him quietly, while you were under the water, what did you want more than anything else? The young man thought for a minute and then answered, I wanted air. I wanted air more than anything else. The old man replied, when you want God as much as you want His air, you will find me. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. And Jesus said this in Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Are you really hungry and thirsty for God? Because that's when you get filled. If you're not really hungry, perhaps you're filling up on other stuff. We talked about this in our group on Wednesday night. Sometimes, think about little kids. When they come home from school and they're hungry, but mom's got dinner almost done. What does mom say to the kids? Don't spoil your dinner with a snack. Right? Something like that. Or if you have a snack, it's going to be limited because I want you to eat good at supper. In church, sometimes it's the same way in the spiritual realm. We fill up on junk. You know, here's some examples on junk. Possessions. power, and the list goes on and on, things that we try to find some satisfaction in. But I want to tell you, those things never really satisfy. He who dies with the most toys still dies. Okay? Possessions really don't amount to anything in the end. So sometimes we just need to get rid of the junk. And you can always simply begin by asking God for a new hunger. If you're sitting here today and you're hearing me talk about renewal, you're hearing about the hunger of God, hunger for the things of God, and you're thinking, if I'm really honest, I guess I'm not all that hungry for the things of God. Then you need to stop right there and say, Lord, help me to be hungry. That's a great place to start. Lord, I don't want to be apathetic. I don't want to be filled up on other junk. Help me to be hungry for the things of God. And I mentioned that this theme of renewal is popping up everywhere. You know, I started on this simply because I felt like God spoke into our church with that prophetic word, and then we built on it, and then I'm starting to see this everywhere. I mentioned our stuck small group. And then I encountered these online videos called Unstuck. And then those kind of lead into another group of videos online called Renewing Your Mind. And then just last week, I got an email from one of my favorite authors with a new book that he has out called Reset. And I'm thinking, this is showing up everywhere. And I've had a couple people tell me that they are aware of another church somewhere else that's kind of talking on this same theme. So this is, I believe God is really speaking to the church. He wants to bring renewal. And so God is reaching out. He's calling out. He's saying, I'm here. Do you want to be renewed? Isaiah 55, verse 6 says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. He's here. He's sounding the alarm. He's setting the word out. Reset, renew, get unstuck. So call on him while he's here. Church, it's time for us to plant. And it's time to plow. And it's time to pursue. So let's do this. Let's plant the good that we know to do. Let's plow up the hardened parts of our lives. And let's pursue God wholeheartedly as our top priority. Amen? Let's prepare the way.